So, Walls, first of all, I would like to say some words in Arabic. Let's try. Salam alaikum. Ana fahura ubi mabsuta bidani ana haikun kimasa. Shukran. Thank you so much. It's really an honor to be here in Cairo, Egypt today. My grandfather and mother was from Aleppo, Syria, and I'm half also Italian because my grandparents from mother's side was from Italy. But we have a strong influence of the Arabic culture in my home, back home. So really it's an honor and I'm really so happy to be here with you today. I would like to gratefully and sincerely thank you. So I would like to gratefully and sincerely thank Professor Dr. Ahmed Alkins, Professor Dr. Ashraf Mahan, and all the faculties for this great invitation. Thank you. So, as a time point of doing this presentation, you might see asking some questions or even ask Dr. Ashraf could help me to translate some words. Okay? It will be hard to understand my English. Okay? So I will start this presentation back home saying that scientific basis leads us to evidence-based medicine. So what is evidence-based medicine? Evidence-based medicine is the link between scientific research and good clinical practice. Evidence-based medicine is comprised of four important components that you listen every day of in the road in your practice of EDM. So they are effectiveness, efficacy, efficiency, and safety. Effectiveness is under treatment work under real condition. So new our patients going back to the follow-up visits. Will our patients going to take the drugs as prescribed by the doctor? Will our patients going to do the complementary examination for a bad diagnosis test and so on. So we usually use the words effectiveness for systematic reviews when the treatment is supposed to work under real conditions. Okay? So efficacy stands for treatment that works under ideal conditions. Usually we use the term efficacy for research related to surgeries, okay? Where it depends more of the experts of the surgeon guy, of the surgeon, rather than the barriers that surround the patients to get access to that medication, okay, or that treatment. So third, we have the efficiency. Efficiency is related to the treatment. Is the treatment cheap and accessible for that population? So we want in the evidence-based medicine context also to look for efficiency. And last, safety would be regarding the reduction of toxicity and side effects. Okay? That's okay. Are you understanding my English? Yes. So, what is evidence-based medicine? So, evidence-based medicine was defined in 1996 as the conscious, explicit, and judicious use of the best available evidence from healthcare research in the management of patients. In other words, evidence-based medicine use existing and available scientific evidence with good internal validity is regarding methodology, to apply its results in the practice. Okay? So the first step to practice evidence-based medicine. What would be the first step to practice evidence-based medicine? So it is the formulation of a good clinical question. So a good clinical question should be formulated also based on four components. And this acronym PICO is very known in the evidence-based medicine world. And the P stands for patient or problem. So we should define first what is the disease under research. Intervention, what is the intervention of interest? Control group, so to see if the intervention of interest is more efficacious or more effective or safe for that population, we need to compare the standard of care, or we need to compare this with no intervention or even placebo. And last, we will look for outcomes that would be primary or secondary results. So keep in mind that the well-formulated clinical question is the first and most important step of evidence-based medicine. If you don't formulate your clinical question based on people, you can easily have bias during the conclusion of your research. Bias would be all kinds of systematic errors during the design, conclusion, and interpretation of any kind of type of research. Okay? So, when we are thinking to do a research about intervention, probably you guys are going to do your master's degree or PhD degree and you need to do thesis, right? So it's very common in the systematic review as master and PhD thesis. It's very easy. You just need to know the steps to conduct it, okay? So when you're going to construct your title for intervention of clinical question, we usually have three ways to construct this title. First, we can say the intervention for a particular problem, and here I think you cannot read at the end, at the very back, because it's in green color, I'm sorry about that. But I just wrote down an example about imatinib to treat gastrointestinal stromal tumors. The second example would be intervention A, that intervention B that leads would be the comparison group for a particular problem. For example, a galactose alpha versus a galactose beta for Fabry disease. And last, we could even construct your title as intervention for gout problem in a particular subspecimen group of population. For example, cryoablation for small renal cell carcinoma in recidivism population. So note that the title has the intervention of interest, the population, at least both of the key components. So that's it. The people that will be reading your thesis know in a first impression what you want to research. And then the objective you will define this in much deeper details. Okay? And you also have the systematic review starts with interventional research, okay, to answer intervention clinical questions. But we also have systematic reviews that aim to answer diagnostic clinical questions. And nowadays we have a cooperative group that's working in a methodology to do systematic reviews about prognosis. I will talk a little bit more later. So for diagnostic tests in clinical questions, we have index test wants to prove is more sensitive and specific than the reference standard. So here we could have nucleic acid amplification techniques versus ELISA followed by Western blot for early diagnosis of HIV-1 in low-middle income countries. So we have nucleic acid amplification as the index test compared to the reference standard. Another way to diagnose gastrointestinal questions for systematic review would be intervention for the health problem in a subsetting group, a specific subsetting group. So we could have as an example rapid diagnosis tests for diagnosing complicated falciparum malaria in many countries. Okay? These are just examples of titles to express what you want to search about. So, as soon as you formulate your clinical question based on the four components, patients, intervention, control group, and outcome, the second step to practice EBM would be to identify the best evidence with which to answer this question. So, I always say, tell my students that each clinical question in the health field has a particular type of study that will better answer this question, because the study will have a more appropriate methodology to answer a certain clinical question. If, for instance, you want to know the prevalence of neuropathic pain, you want to translate that neuropathic pain? If you want to know the prevalence of neuropathic pain in high city, so you look for or conduct cross-section research. Okay? If, for instance, you want to know the characteristics of lupus disease, we look for or conduct case control studies, because we know that lupus disease is a rare disease. Okay? If, for instance, you want to know the sensitivity or specificity of a certain diagnosis test, you look for or conduct diagnosis studies. And last, if you want to know, if you want to know about the prognosis, would be association between a risk factor and an outcome. For example, a risk factor, abdominal obesity, abdominal adiposity, if it is in the future, will come to develop diabetes. So we will look for a conduct cohort studies. And last, if you want to see the effectiveness, efficacy, safe, and safe of a certain treatment, we will look for and conduct which kind of clinical trials, so randomized clinical trials. So what are randomized clinical trials? So clinical trials is studies that are conducted in human beings. Experimental studies conducted in human beings. Okay? Randomized, you see that randomized is allocation that we cannot predict which participants will go to the intervention group or which participants will go to control group. Because if we predict it, we can suddenly influence it and put some good prognosis patients in the treatment to prove that this treatment is more efficacious. And so we will be overestimated the effect of this treatment. Okay? So randomized controlled trials are considered the level 2 of evidence. It's almost as the higher topic of the level of evidence. Why? Because they have a control group, okay? They are prospective in their nature, and they have the organization process. That is a result that looking for the organization process, and they figure it out that clinical trials with a group with adequate randomization reduce bias during the results in 30%. It's a lot. So what is randomization? Randomization is the random draw, right? A random draw, you can do it by dice or in memory. It ensures that each patient has an equal choice of receiving any treatment from this study. So I need to be fair enough with all my patients, right? And to give them 50% of chance to be in the intervention or in the control group, I will run them. So we probably Dr. Ashraf will talk about the bias that is surrounding the randomized controlled trials. And one of the bias is the selection bias. So if the randomization process is not adequate, so it means that this study is can have a high risk of bias in its results. It means that you cannot trust in those results. Okay? So, often randomization prevents selection bias. So, selection bias of Russia, we talk about this, is the randomization process. To avoid selection bias, we have to do a good randomization. And the random numbers can be generated by computers. Now we have software that generates randomization. Or even by dice, raw dice. Okay? So now we know that the first step to practice basic medicine is formulate a good clinical questions. And believe me, it's the hardest step. A lot of teachers back home have a hard time to put their thoughts and their ideas into that four important components. So you need to practice. And once you get the way, you will go with any clinical question that you choose. So the second step is to figure out which kind of study will answer your clinical question with more confidence. Okay? If you are good in paranormalism. And now, we just know that randomized controlled trials are at the highest level of the evidence, but I forgot to tell you that randomized controlled trials answer questions about treatment. That should be in Canada. Yeah. So, randomized controlled trials will answer questions about effectiveness, efficacy, safety, about a certain treatment, okay? And about a prevention program. So, what would be better than an RCT? I told you that RCT is in the second level of evidence from the hierarchy. Pyramid, and better than RCT to answer clinical about questions about treatment and prevention would be they know everything. I don't need to be here.
Go with the session.
Let's go to the session.
I have something
failure that the fact of somebody trying to stop the door isn't concerned.
Oh! That's amazing. Okay. So, does this mass reveals a type of literature review, okay, that aims to focus in a particular clinical question, right? And that aims to identify, appraise, select, and synthesize the high quality research. So, for instance, if you are doing a systematic review about Dallas Alpha, as I showed you, to treat Fabry disease, and you don't find RCTs about this, and you don't find the best quality research, so you can conclude with cases you discuss, can you? Actually, this is a kind of contradictory. There is authors that use the lowest level of evidence to supply the physicians why we don't have RCTs. And I use the lowest level of evidence to supply the absence of RCTs, okay? However, you should be in mind that they are low level of evidence in the hierarchy, and you should take carefully into consideration those conclusions. But I cannot call this type of research using lowest level of evidence as systematic review. Okay? So systematic review should be concluded on basis on high quality research. So if I'm talking about treatment and prevention, that systematic review should conclude based on RCTs. If perhaps I'm talking about prognosis, that systematic review should conclude based on cohort studies, and so on. So systematic reviews are conducted according to explicit and reproducible methodology. So that's why they are the top of the pyramid, because they have a good structure, a good methodology. So anyone in the world, if they will duplicate your work, they should find the same results. Okay, they should find. So let's, for instance, say that we have all RCTs spread out in the literature about DAS alpha to treat Fabry disease. And the reviewer would have told to seek for all those RCTs that talk about DAS alpha to treat Fabry disease. Then they organize those RCTs, and then the reviewer will come up with three possible conclusions. One conclusion is they find good RCTs, they find the RCTs with huge sample size and good internal validity, and they can truly confirm the efficacy of that treatment or even refute the treatment of the investigation. The second possible conclusion of the systematic review is that you found the RCTs, but the RCTs are poorly reported or was poorly conducted, because the methodology was not well conducted, or the sample size is small, and with a small sample size, you cannot detect a statistical power. Okay? And when the review is called in the second category, the review will say there is no strong evidence to support or even refute this treatment. Further RCTs are needed. Okay? And the third possible conclusion of the systematic review is absence evidence. What this means, absence of evidence?
Seems to me that things don't match up together, or might be studies are contradicting each other, something like that.
Actually, that one that you told me, just told you that the results are contradicted, would fall in the second category. So we found some evidence, but there is no strong evidence, we still are in doubt about that. This first category is more specific. And now we can think, but can I do a systematic review without more seat? Can I? You can, actually you can. You can do a systematic review without RCT. Why? Because you are mapping the epistemology and you will alert the scientific community to conduct RCTs about this topic. Because there was no RCT. So you needed to alert the international scientific community about the necessity to conduct clinical trials on that particular topic. Okay? So systematic reviews are usually often. And it means that there is no RCT found in the literature. Do you guys understand this? Perfect. Thank you so much, Dr. Ayman. So, systematic review aims to find all relevant research studies published and not published. You guys are thinking now, how come the review will find unpublished studies? Is he a magician? No. There is a talk that we have to find unpublished studies, and I will not talk it later. And systematic reviews aims to synthesize the findings in an unbiased way because the methodology is so rigorous. It's so, adequate. Okay? And presents a balanced and impartial summary of the findings, taking any flaws into consideration. So here, there is no space to my opinion. My opinion. You can have your opinion, and it's very healthy to have your opinion. But you should take this opinion and put it formulated in the four important components and then conduct your research. And after that, you can present these results of our research in a conference, and you will better be listened. Rather than tell only that in my hospital I did and I was successful. No, prove this. Okay? So, we go to systematic reviews and meta-analyses at the highest level of evidence. That's true. But I need to correct me a little bit. Systematic review are at the highest level of the parameter, but it can have or cannot have meta-analysis. So now we talk about meta-analysis. Meta-analysis is only a statistical calculation applied to the included studies of a particular review. Okay? It's only a statistical calculation. So, a systematic review can have an analysis if the included studies are homogeneous in their nature. Okay? What I mean about homogeneous in their nature? I mean that they evaluate the same outcomes and then plot this in a meta-analysis. Okay? And also, we can have RCTs that talks about specific outcomes, but it is not reporting the specific data to feed the revenue. Okay? So, to do a systematic review, we can come up to meta-analyze or not, or no meta-analyze. It will depend on the data from all the entities included in that statutory master agreement. So now I give another information. This master reveals 10 heavy meta-analyses, which or without meta-analyses are still at the top. Again, because I just met this knowledge of a particular topic, and you come up with three possible conclusions and alert the scientific community about what I just have found. Okay. So you can see this beautiful symbol right here. And this is the logo, the symbol of cognitive collaboration. Cognitive collaboration is an international organization that aims to prepare, maintain, and disseminate systematic reviews. Okay? So this is the symbol of the cognitive collaboration. You can note that the external part of the symbol, some of the people there say that this stands for C, C, letter C, as company. And the C here as collaboration. Okay? But what is most interesting for us is that the graph and the leader part. So this was a two meta-analysis that answered the following question. Is corticosteroid more effective and safe compared to placebo in the reduction of mortality and maternal mortality when you give to a woman about to give birth to early? So this was the clinical question. So this was the question formulated based on four components. Then we did a systematic review and they come up with this meta-analysis. So follow with me. The vertical line is the line of the null hypothesis. So if we divide the circle and we say that on the left side we could favor the treatment, in that example we could favor corticosteroids, and the right side it would favor the control group, in that case would be placebo. Okay? We can say that if something falls here in this vertical line, there is no hypothesis. It didn't favor neither the corticosteroids or the placebo. Each horizontal line is RCT, a study that was included in this particular review. So how many studies were included in this particular review? Wow, yes, perfect, 7 studies. 7 studies. So, shorter line, more precise might be results. Why? So you get that amazing. Yeah, so it's more my line, so more participants I can study. So I have a big sample size. Longer line, I have a longer confidential interval, right? And less participants was included in the RCT. So if it is this horizontal line touch or cross the vertical line, touch the same as that one, okay, or cross like that, it means that
sim, são beta, são beta sujeitos da luz ou da droga, são beta, não sujeitos da luz ou da droga.
Yes, perfect. So, in other words, in technical words, you would say that there is no statistical existe a significância difference between both studies and studies, ok? But what is the most important here in this graph would be the diamonds. The diamond is all the data plotted in this graph. So all the data plotted, I make it huge sample size and I increase my statistical power. And when I increase my statistical power, I will probably find that statistical significance difference when this is true. So looking for the diamond, you can now say that corticosteroids works or not. I'm just doing a question.
Yes.
Yes, it works, right? Because this is not the rational mind.
Yes.
Okay, and it's in the left side, right?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, so it's very easy to interpret a meta-analysis. If perhaps there was no systematic review and did someone interesting to answer this question would go to the electronic database and they would come probably with these tools. And probably if they don't know what is this medicine or if they didn't practice this yet, they would probably go to the latest publication, thinking that it's more up to date. Right? And actually the latest publication, dated 1991, say that there is no statistical significance difference between corticosteroids and placebo. So here, probably the clinician wouldn't use the corticosteroids if he goes only for the results of one single episode. You understand this? So this is the requirement of the hierarchy level. There is a more complex parameter, but to teach it, this is best. So you can see the top of this parameter are the systematic reviews, okay? That now we know that can answer any kind of clinical questions we have field. In the second level of evidence, we have the RCTs that we know that can answer questions about treatment and prevention. And the third level, they are the cohort studies. Cohort studies, you remember at the beginning of our presentation that I said that cohort studies aim to answer questions about prognosis. So why is in the third level? What this kind of studies don't have that they are actually have? Control. They have the control, they also have randomization. They lack the randomization process. Okay, so that's why we are in the third level of advancing. But of course they lack the randomization process, because they are good to answer prognostic questions. If perhaps I would like to know the association between cigarettes and breast cancer, right? Would it be fair to randomize people that don't smoke to smoke? No. So that's why cohort studies are observational studies. So they are good to answer questions about association of a risk factor and outcome. So if perhaps here in my slide, I would have written hierarchy of evidence for prognostic studies. What I would do? Have in the second level.
Prognosis.
And then I would drop away the RCTs, because RCTs are natural to do with questions about prognosis issues. Okay? Perfect. So the base of the parameter is the expert of opinion. is the animal research and also the in vitro research, okay? The other important events, the other important create hypotheses to be tested in high quality research. Oh, I have an idea. I think that this medication will lower the survival of my patients. But there are no RCTs or there are no systematic reviews. So let's conduct one. Or let's try to do a systematic review. Okay? So you guys perhaps already have done an narrative review, were you? Have you done a narrative review before? Have you? So narrative review, I had done this in my beginning of my career. And narrative review is just a review that you don't follow reader's methods. So what are the differences between systematic reviews and narrative reviews? So first, the difference with regard to the question is that narrative reviews don't follow the big question, the big structure. So it's easy, I start with, for example, what's the best treatment for cancer? And then end up saying about the prevalence of cancer, okay? So it's easy to get lost when you don't specify your clinical question.
Excuse me. Narrative review is what we call SE during the post-American system, okay? This is the difference between systematic review and BES.
Thank you so much for the planet for the clarification. So much. So systematic review formulating the clinical question based on the four components, like narrative reviews don't follow this structure, okay? Second point between differences of these both reviews. Why do we have a search strategy to scrutinize all the literature and to verify all the possible RCTs that match that inclusion criteria? In the narrative review, we often take the papers that are more comfortable for us. You understand? We don't do search strategy. We don't go for manual search. And the critical appraisal for systematic reviews, we use tools that Dr. Ashraf will present for you today. Specific tools to rank if that paper is high risk of bias, if that paper is low risk of bias, okay? And the synthesis from systematic reviews are both qualitative and quantitative, while the narrative reviews are only qualitative, okay? So don't waste your time and resources doing a narrative review. You should follow the systematic review, okay? That you will have a much greater feedback from systematic reviews. So this night, sir, was the company, Archibald Lennon Cochrane, who was a British epidemiologist who first set out clearly the vital importance to do high quality research. Okay? So he just said in 1979, he said, "It's surely a great sense of our profession that we have not organized a critical summary by specialty, for example, cardiology, or specialty arrhythmia, adapted periodically of all relevant randomized controlled trials." So, after this appeal, in 1996, the first Cochrane Center was created in UK. 1992. In 1996, the other 10 Cochrane centers was inaugurated. Okay? And we do hope that Egypt can have a Cochrane center soon. With the work of you and Professor Dr. Ashraf and Professor Dr. Ahmed. So, Cochrane centers help people that want to do systematic reviews. They give support for them. Okay? And we also have 53 Cochrane collaborative groups. These Cochrane collaborative groups are team specifying in a certain kind of disease. So, for example, depression, Cochrane group, drugs and alcohol, ear, nose and throat disorders, epilepsy, and so on. So, if you, for instance, see, what's your name? Iman. If for instance, Iman wants to do a systematic review and she wants to do a systematic review about cardiology, right? So she wants to contact the heart company group to see, to verify the possibility to register a clinical question. And if she registers the clinical questions, no one in the world can register the same clinical question in the Cochrane Heart Group. So we also save the time for the others. We don't need to do duplicated jobs. It's hard to know what you guys are doing here and what I am doing right back in Brazil. You understand? So if you do register those systematic reviews in both Cochrane collaboration and even prosperity database, we easily can know what's going on around the world. Okay? So, in 2011, we just inaugurated the evidence-based medicine unit back in the Emory University. And this unit works with each teacher, each professor, or students that are experts in their specific area, and it integrates with our methodological and clinical epidemiology expertise. So it's easy to do systematic review and share data.
Yeah, we just started a few weeks ago. And before the way, Ukraine Journal Club.
Oh, that
you promote Ukraine technology and sensible society.
That's so nice. Yes, sir. In this time, students are all having a unity as well.
Excuse me?
You just created a unity, sorry.
Yeah, just a call. It's not a unit.
Welcome to the creation of Cochrane activities and we start with a Facebook page.
Very nice, Dr. Ahmed. I remember it was like 1 month ago you just started, right? Very nice, great. So this is like first step to together more people to join us, right? And to doing this much review. So this, we do the integration between the physician and our methodology expertise, and we have weekly meetings. So we go faster in the conclusion of the master review. We have also 40 master reviews registered throughout the company collaboration groups. And other projects, research projects is ongoing as well. It's very nice. You are all invited to go to Brazil to visit our systematic review units. Okay? So systematic review is useful when the studies are small to detect genes. And when the results of this study are contradictory. So So I make
you guys understand the importance of systematic reviews with this example. So let's suppose that I ask Iman, where is Iman? Iman, right? What's your name?
My name is Muhammad.
Muhammad. Iman, Muhammad. Iman two. Iman one, Muhammad, Iman, and
Ahmed.
Ahmed. To go to the Tantas University Library and search for rizatriptan versus placebo to treat headache. But I want to, wait, only 10 milligrams of rizatriptan. And then the girls, Iman, go to the library faster. Muhammad follow them. After goes Ahmed. And the first one to get here was Iman one. Iman first. So Iman first showed me this article. And she said, Regina, see, it's a well professor teacher here. He is very well known about his published papers. And she said, but unfortunately, there was no statistical significance difference. I said, okay, Iman, let's wait. Let's see the other guys. So after that, Muhammad comes quickly and say, that one was published in Cephalalgia. Cephalalgia has a great impact factor. And the guy say that there was really a significant difference favoring rizatriptano. So I get confused because the paper of Imra say that there was no difference between rizatriptano and placebo, while the paper from Muhammad say that there is. Wait, guys, let's see Ahmed. Ahmed come and found this paper. He said it was in a huge sample size. A huge sample size was studied. And he said, sorry, I have to agree with Imra. There was no statistical significance difference. So our hopefully now is Ahmed. Right? Ahmed. So Ahmed come and bring the fourth paper. And the fourth paper say there was a significant difference. So now I ask you, what should we do with conflicting research results while we have here two papers published about the same clinical question, saying that rizatriptan doesn't work for the relief of the headache, while two others published studies saying that it really works. So what we should do in this case?
Meta-analysis.
Perfect. Better than meta-analysis, a systematic review. Remember, we should follow the systematic review steps. If we're gonna figure out if you're gonna end with meta-analysis or not, this is another problem. So we just need to start with systematic review. Okay, so the answer would be systematic review with or without meta-analysis. Okay, so the smartest way is to do a systematic review and then plot the studies into a meta-analysis. And what you are just seeing here, the graph, you can see even those four articles, they are here, right? They are plotted here. With more two articles. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 studies talking about the effectiveness of rizatriptano versus placebo to treat headache. And we just see from the 6 papers that only 2 studies found a statistically significant difference between rizatriptano compared to placebo. So even if we let's go with the majority, we would be not doing the best clinical practice, okay? And the others, Because the others here say that there was not a difference. Only two of them say that rizatriptan works. You understand? So what really matters here would be the diamond. So plotting all these included studies, I increase my sample size, I detect a statistical power, and I came up with the conclusion that if so, here it's the opposite, okay? The right side is favoring rizatriptano, and the left side is favoring placebo. I'm so okay. So I just go finish that thought. I just finish this and go, yeah. So why it's the right side is favoring treatment? Why here the treatment is in the right side? This is a little bit tricky. The treatment is in the right side, okay? Because we are evaluating a positive outcome. Always in Cochrane reviews, when we evaluate a positive outcome, we should change the labels here. Otherwise, it doesn't work the contingency table, okay? So, looking for the diamonds, we can see the probability of the group which received rizatriptan in reducing migraine in a period of 30 minutes is 1.47 times more than the placebo group. So we have just a risk relative of 1.45. So it's better to give rizatriptan. So I just got a note here that we are running out of time. And now I want to because we don't have time, I just want to go to the last slides to show you something new for you. Is that okay? So it's like an important message now. So although the systematic reviews has a great structure, I mean has a perfect methodology, it is lacking the RCTs and primary studies to feed the systematic reviews. Often we come up with the third conclusion. Do you remember the three possible conclusions? So we just published two papers. One was in 2004 and another one in 2011. We wanted to look for the reviews, which conclusions that they comment. So the majority of the reviews, like almost 50% in both samples, conclude no RCTs. So conclude that there is no evidence, right, to refute or confirm that treatment. So almost 50% said insufficient evidence, and the authors did ask for further research. Okay? So this in all the health field area. So now we have to also struggle to create centers that work to disseminate productions of primary studies. So it's good to do systematic review, but we need to also incentivize the productions of primary studies. So I want to end this presentation saying that a great criticism of the evidence-based medicine age nowadays is that we have not produced high-quality primary studies in mass with worldwide centers participation and in accordance to the predefined Cochrane's protocol to cover all those systematic reviews that did not offer enough evidence for clinical practice. Okay? So systematic reviews are good. We still need to produce them, but also we need to think on the primary studies. Okay? So thank you so much for your attention. Shukran.